Hello, and welcome to the presentation on hyperacute management of ischemic stroke. My name is Wai Mei, and I'm happy to be presenting this together with Deidre De Silva. At the end of this presentation, you have learned how to assess acute stroke patient, the indication benefits and risks of intravenous thrombolysis and endovascular treatment, other medical management issues for hyperacute stroke. The presentation will be divided into three sections: assessment, reperfusion treatments, and other medical management. Time is brain and is critical in hyperacute stroke. Therefore, assessment of patients needs to be as efficient as possible. A team-based approach with concurrent processes helps to save time in the assessment of a stroke patient. As part of the clinical examination, one should take the vital signs, in particular noting the blood pressure and heart rhythm. History taking should be brief to the point. Important facts that need to be established are time of onset of symptoms, assessment of symptoms to localize the lesion and to determine its progression, pointed ascertainment of contraindication for thrombolysis. The physical examination involved a neurological examination with measurement of the National Institute of Health Stroke Scale. One should also conduct a cardiac examination and to examine the patient for any injuries. In addition, the blood sugar level should be taken and noted. If time permits, the patient should be asked about their weight, or you may have to weigh the patient.
In addition to clinical examination, there also must be an imaging assessment. A brain CT or MRI is done in the hyperacute phase. What we want to know are the following. There's no acute or subacute hemorrhage, the presence and extent of early ischemic change, and the aspect score can help us to determine this. One should also look for any possible signs on imaging of a stroke mimic. And finally, if an angiogram is being performed, one should note the presence of a large artery obstruction for the assessment for suitability for endovascular treatment. Here are some examples of early ischemic change. In the top row, we see seating findings of loss of the insular ribbon, loss of gray-white differentiation, and loss of the sulci, as well as obscuration of the lentiform nucleus. And below are MRI features of acute ischemic change with hyperintensity on the DWI and hypointensity correspondingly on the ADC sequences. The aspect score allows one to estimate early ischemic change. The MCA territory is divided into 10 sections. Each patient who is normal has an aspect score of 10. For each area that is affected, 1 point is deducted. We now move on to the second part on the presentation on reperfusion. The concept of reperfusion is demonstrated here. One aims to recanalize an arterial obstruction to reperfuse potentially salvageable tissue in order to attenuate infarct growth, with the ultimate aim of improving functional outcome. Intravenous alteplase is one acute stroke reperfusion strategy. Alteplase is a tissue plasminogen activator which acts as a fibrinolytic agent. It is proven to be beneficial in the first 4.5 hours after stroke onset. The CLE inclusion criteria are no increased risk of hemorrhage from the history and physical examination, no raised blood pressure above specific levels, and no extensive ischemic change on imaging. Intravenous alteplase improves long-term functional outcome. The number needed to treat to gain functional independence is 8 to 14, and for any functional improvement, the number needed to treat is 3. There are some risks associated with alteplase, including symptomatic intracranial hemorrhage. There can be an allergic reaction to the medication, and of note, there's no change in survival with intravenous alteplase. The other reperfusion strategy is endovascular treatment using a stent retriever device. This has been proven beneficial in the first 6 to 8 hours from onset. There must be a large arterial obstruction, the blood pressure should be within the required range, and there should not be extensive ischemic change on imaging. There are 3 indications for endovascular treatment over intravenous alteplase. It can be given beyond 4.5 hours up to 8 hours. It can be given to patients with contraindication to systemic fibrinolysis, such as those with recent trauma and on oral anticoagulation, and it can be given concomitantly after intravenous alteplase. The benefits of endovascular therapy are an increased likelihood of independence with a number needed to treat of 7 and better functional improvement with a number needed to treat of 2.6. There are risks with endovascular therapy. This includes the risk of symptomatic intracranial hemorrhage, which is similar to that of intravenous alteplase. There are also complications related to the procedure itself, and similar to intravenous alteplase, endovascular therapy does not change survival.
Now we move on to post-reperfusion care. The patient may be monitored in the stroke unit. Patient's neurological status and vital signs need to be monitored closely, and the intervals are as suggested. Blood pressure management is important. Systolic blood pressure should be less than 180 mm mercury, and diastolic blood pressure should be lesser than 105 mm mercury. Do not insert invasive lines unless medically indicated. Some patients may develop allergy to TPA. In particular, there is a risk of oral lingual angioedema. Do monitor the mouth and tongue at the intervals recommended. Do inform the doctor if any of the following is present: high blood pressure beyond the target set, neurological deterioration on NIHSS or Glasgow Coma Scale, severe headache, nausea or vomiting, bleeding from any source, allergy reactions such as angioedema. Do stop TPA immediately if the infusion was still ongoing. Brain imaging will need to be repeated when there is a neurological deterioration or 24 hours post-TPA. Avoid antithrombotics in the first 24 hours. For those who have undergone endovascular treatment, the femoral sheath may still be in situ. Patients will need to have complete bed rest and try to keep the affected limb straight to reduce bleeding. The puncture site will need to be observed for bleeding, hematoma, or increase in girth in the lower extremity every hour. Other signs of bleeding may include tachycardia or hypotension. It is important to assess for severe pain, especially in the abdomen, groin, or back. This may be signs of dissection. Do monitor lower limbs for circulation every hour. Do inform the doctor if there are any of the following: bleeding or increase in girth, other signs of bleeding such as hypotension or tachycardia, severe pain, or compromised circulations to the lower limb.
The mainstay of stroke management beyond reperfusion treatment is care in an acute stroke unit. This is defined as geographically locating stroke patients in the same area under the care of a team of professionals who are trained in stroke care. This is a very strong intervention. It saves lives. Stroke unit reduces mortality with a number needed to treat of 26. It also improves functional outcome. This intervention is cost-effective, has no risk, and is applicable to all patients. How does care in a stroke unit improve outcome? The effect of a stroke unit is probably a combination of many different factors, many of which are listed here. In addition to stroke unit care, other aspects of medical management include blood pressure control, management of glucose and fever, as well as venous thromboembolism prophylaxis. So in summary, stroke is treatable, time is brain, acute assessment and decision making should be rapid and coordinated. There are clear benefits of reperfusion strategies of intravenous thrombolysis and endovascular therapy. It is important to select cases appropriately. There is medical management beyond reperfusion. Stroke unit care is key and reduces mortality and improves function. We hope that you have learned the basics of hyperacute stroke care from this presentation, and thank you for your attention.